All right.
We are good.
For recording? Okay. Looks like we're about at time also, so. So last time, we started taking a look at sequences. Aaron. Sabrina. Barbara. So last time, we introduced the concept of sequences, talked a bit about limits and converging and diverging, when that happens. And today what I wanted to do is continue on talking about sequences, looking specifically at when some techniques for finding the limits for certain things. Now, we ended last time with a discussion of monotonic and bounded sequences. So I want to start with that, just to kind of talk about how do we show that something is monotonic, how do we show that something is bounded. Right, we'll start with that. Then we will go into another theorem for finding limits called the squeeze theorem. Basically, I'll state it so that you are aware it exists. And then what I want to do is talk a bit about how to tell whether certain rational functions converge or diverge when they are viewed as sequences. And that's sort of what we'll be talking about today. If at any point you aren't here, we do have the videos. I am putting them up on a Blackboard. It takes a while, but because it's like a gig of data. But it is up there, so for example, I know you weren't here. If you get a chance on Blackboard, it should be on their video lectures. It's a little tough to see the writing. So what I recommended in the email, I think, is if you can get the notes from somebody and then listen along, that might help. That might be a good way to go. But you see how it works, see how it goes through just from me narrating.
Do you
keep
them there, or
I will probably have to delete them after a while. I don't know what kind of storage we have on Blackboard, because each one is about a gig and a quarter. So we'll see how that goes. I know Dr. DeMarco used YouTube last time, so I might try to do that if it starts taking a little too long, or however that works. But yeah, we'll figure it out. But I'll try to keep it up there as long as I can. If it starts slowing things down, or they say, you can't put more on here, then I'll start deleting some stuff. Okay? All right. So, first, bounded sequences. I mentioned last time that any sequence of the form constant over an increasing function. So let k be some number, I don't care. N is, n is a, or the terms of the sequence, right? N, 1, 2, 3, 4. So those are the input values. As long as that denominator is increasing towards infinity, regardless of how fast it's getting there, if the denominator is increasing to infinity, the top number is constant, then that sequence converges to zero. Right? That's the statement we made, but I said we weren't going to quite prove that yet. Well, I'm going to use this theorem that we learned last time, right? That if a sequence is monotonic and bounded, then it converges. Okay, so that's what we're going to use here. That doesn't necessarily tell us where it converges to, so I need a little bit stronger statement, making sure that we know it converges to zero. But for now, we can show that it definitely does converge. So bounded sequences, it's really a matter of saying there's some value that I will never go above. So in this case, if we are assuming that n is always increasing, let's assume for the moment that k is positive. Doesn't have to be, but for our example, let k be positive. Okay. Then I can use k as an upper bound. If k were negative, then I would be using k as a lower bound. K can be an upper bound because as this goes through, right, if I look at the terms of the sequence, I have k divided by 2, k divided by 3, whatever k happens to be, we are taking this positive value and breaking it up into smaller and smaller pieces by dividing by these natural numbers. So we'll never have a value which is larger than k. And so we don't get too much into formal proofs in this class, but if you were told to, you know, justify something being bounded, we'll say we can start with k. Every term will be below it because I'm dividing it into smaller and smaller pieces. So is everyone okay with that quick justification for why k could be an upper bound? I won't have anything in this list that's ever more than that number. And then in this case, for a lower bound, I'm going to use 0. The reason why I would use 0 is because this will never become negative. I'm assuming k is positive in my original discussion. I'm using natural numbers as a sequence, because that's usually what a sequence is, the natural numbers, sometimes 0. A lot of times we'll start with 1. So I'm never dividing by a negative. My denominator is always positive. So it's always positive divided by positive, which is positive. So I have 0 as a lower bound. Now, I didn't write out my reasoning, right? If this was on a homework, possible homework question, you may have to write some of that out. Since the numerator and denominator are both always positive, it can never be negative, so a 0 is a lower bound. That's the reasoning why. So showing boundedness, not too tough. In this case, it's not too tough. You just want to try to find something above and below where I'll never get out of that range. But like we mentioned before, that is not enough. We also need to show monotonicity. And again, just to be formal, I'm saying it's something that's always non-increasing or always non-decreasing. The reason, again, why I'm saying non-increasing as opposed to decreasing is because we can have it be constant through there. There can be elements where it is not moving at all. That's fine. As long as it's not going up in the first example or not going down in the second example. We're fine. Right. So, how to show that? In a case like this, I think the easiest way to show it for something like this is to convert it from a sequence to a function. So instead of k over n, I'm going to take a look at the function k over x. I'm going to rewrite that in a more comfortable way, k times x to the negative 1. Everyone okay with that? Remember that from before? Okay. Now, does anybody happen to know what I could do offhand to take a look at an entire function and determine whether or not it's always moving downward or always moving upward? What could I do with the function to find that? Think back to calc 1. If I take the derivative, so if I take the derivative here, this uses the basic power rule. I multiply out by the negative 1 in front, subtract 1 from the exponent. So something like this, negative k over x squared. What did I say about k before I even started this? It's constant, and we said that's going to make it positive. So now, what's the status of my numerator? My numerator is always going to be what sign?
Negative.
Always negative. My denominator, because it's x squared, will always be what sign?
Positive.
Now, even if it weren't x squared, remember that I'm focusing on going to positive infinity. So remember, it doesn't have to be true for the first few steps, but as long as it's eventually always positive, we can work this out. So always negative divided by always positive tells me that that derivative is always where? Always negative up top, always positive on the bottom.
Below zero.
So it's always all negative. Decreasing is a special type of non-increasing, so we are monotonic. A negative, an always negative derivative tells me that it's always moving downward. It's always decreasing. Or an always positive derivative would tell me that it's moving upward. So that's, in many cases, that's a way to go. Will that always work? Not necessarily. Sometimes you may have to kind of get in and mess around with the numbers a little bit, especially if you're dealing with factorials. Remember I mentioned we introduced factorials last time. Those are used a lot in a lot of our sequences and series, but they don't have a nice, neat, functional version, real number version. There is something called the gamma function, and that is a function that was created to replicate factorials. But it is not one that's terribly well known. I would have to look it up. I learned it in advanced calc back in grad school. But just enough to say, hey, it exists. It's a relatively messy function. So there is something called the gamma function, which behaves like factorials, but it's not something that we've had experience with at this level. It's not something I'm necessarily going to introduce. So, questions on demonstrating boundedness or monotonicity? At least these two examples. There may be situations where this one always leads you where you need to go. So other ways of approaching monotonicity. Take the nth term of the sequence, right, a sub n. By that I mean, you know, I'm not plugging any numbers in, I'm just using the formula itself. Compare it to a sub n plus 1, where I take the expression n plus 1 and plug it in. And then take a look and show, hey, this one is always larger than the other. Right. To try that real quick with this one. If I compare k sub n to k sub n plus 1, I can cross multiply. Since k is positive, kn plus k is greater than kn. So that inequality holds up there. So since n plus 1 is always less than n, it is a decreasing sequence. Questions on what I did there or why we did that? Okay. So now we've shown that this sequence, k over n, is bounded and monotonic. It is... has an upper bound, has a lower bound, so it's bounded. It is decreasing, which is a special type of non-increasing, so it is monotonic. That means it has a limit, it does converge. Now, what we've done here isn't quite enough to tell me that it does in fact converge to zero, but it tells me that it converges. To show convergence to zero, you would probably get a little bit more into the formal definition using epsilons and n's and all that. I just wanted to show that to you. Questions, concerns there? The reason I wanted to cover that is I do think some of the homework questions ask you to demonstrate monotonic or bounded. So I just wanted to show you some strategies for approaching that. Okay? So questions there? Thank you. real quick mention something called the squeeze theorem. You may have run across this in Calc 1 when you're talking about limits of real value functions. If we have a sequence, or let me say this, if we have two sequences, that both converge to the same number. So I have sequence A converges to L, sequence B converges to L. Each individual term aren't the same, necessarily. But the limit of the sequences is they both go to the same spot. Then for some sequence where every term is between A and B, that sequence goes to the same spot. For example, let's consider the sine of n over n. I want to find the limit as n approaches infinity. Can you think of a function that sort of acts as a maximum for that as I go across? Maximum. What's the highest value that the sine can hold?
Is it a 1?
What's that?
1.
And what's the lowest value the sine can hold?
0.
On the positive side, yes, but then I can continue on to
negative 1.
So this first step is actually part of probably the trickiest one, figuring out which sequences to compare it to, which functions to compare it to. Right. What is the limit as n approaches infinity of 1 over n? Of negative 1 over n.
Zero.
Negative 0, which is still 0. Right. The negative out front, remember that if you have any constant multipliers in here, you can just bring them out front. Anything that's not directly described using this variable n, if it's multiplied, I can bring that out. So the negative can come outside. Is everyone okay with that statement? That, you know, as n is increasing, negative 1 over n is less than or equal to the sine of n over n. Because n sine of n won't get down to negative 1, it won't go down to any further than that. So the numerator is bounded, the denominator is the same. Everybody okay with that? And then on the upper end, is everyone okay with that? The sine of n never goes above 1. So then dividing by n, that will never go above 1 over whatever n is at the time. So to give you a visual on this, there's 1 over n. There's negative 1 over n. And so then the sine is probably oscillating back and forth between them. I'll go ahead and draw in the straight lines, just make it easier to see that way. Not the straight lines, the solid lines. But as you can see, that those kind of come in, and the sine of n is squeezed between them.
So could you do any function as long as it's below sine of n over n and above it? Did you have to use 1 over n?
Not necessarily, although these, it's easy to describe their behavior. So I went with the simplest ones that I knew that would work.
Okay.
That would go to 0. Yeah. And it's also relatively easy to compare these two. More often than not, this is mostly used to describe why other things work. So you may not have too many opportunities where you actually perform the squeeze theorem, but I just wanted you to see it and see if it made sense as far as what's going on. So questions on that? Okay. Related to this, quick little side theorem. This one I'm just going to state. This is not necessarily true for values in general, but if it goes to 0, if I have a sequence of all positive terms going to 0, then those same terms, if their signs are all over the place, is also going to 0. Again, it doesn't necessarily hold for things that aren't 0. Because of the nature of absolute value, right? I need something that is both positive and negative, or neither positive and negative. Then that holds. The proof of that uses the squeeze theorem. I'm not going to worry about proving it, but I just wanted you to be aware of this. If we can show that all the positives work, then negative versions of it also work. You flip back and forth. Not necessarily true in the other direction. Questions there? That's just a statement. I don't think we have too many questions dealing with it, but I wanted you to be aware of that. Okay. All right, so questions there. So now let's go ahead and take a look at, in general, when we are presented with certain sequences, how can we tell whether or not they converge and where they converge to? So I'm going to start with our rational functions, right? The ones where we have polynomials in the numerator and denominator. Say this is my sequence. Three n squared plus three n minus one, all over n to the third plus n squared minus 5. and we want to determine its behavior as n goes to infinity, as the sequence continues on up forever. There was a technique back in Calc 1, I think I actually remember it from pre-calculus in high school, but I don't know where what you guys had there, for dealing with this sort of limit. We also have a technique that we learned in Calc 2 to deal with this sort of limit. In either case, once you are comfortable with the outcome, I don't necessarily need to see all of the moving pieces. If you can look at that and you can describe the nature of this and how it's supposed to behave, then we're probably fine. Let's go and do it the long way. Let's do the Calc 1 way first. If I had x's in there instead of n's, does anyone happen to remember what I could do with this to determine its behavior?
Could you take the greatest x term on the top, the greatest x term, like the bottom?
We probably have to use the greatest over the whole thing. That's the same thing. Yeah. Take the highest degree monomial that we see. In this case, what is the highest degree that shows up? N to what power? N to the third power. And we'll divide the top and bottom by N to the third. And so we get something like this. Let's simplify some things. This one here becomes what?
3 over n.
3 over n. This one?
3 over n squared.
3 over n squared. Minus 1 over n to the third. And then in my denominator, what do I have with that first term?
1.
N to the third divided by n to the third is 1. Next term. N, and then minus 5 over n to the third. And again, we're looking at the limit as n goes to infinity. In my numerator, every term is of that form, constant over increasing function, right? Constant over going to infinity, constant over going to infinity, constant over going to infinity. And we said those always go to what?
Zero.
So everything in my numerator is going to zero. Everything in my denominator is going to zero except for what?
One.
There's no n here, so that's the one. These guys zero out. So I have a defined outcome. The limit of that sequence is zero. Does that ring bells? Now, we don't have to go through all of the work, but what would I get if instead I had something like this? 3n to the third plus 3n minus 1 over n to the third plus n squared plus 5. Instead of going to 0, where is that going?
3.
That's going to 3. Because if I perform the same technique, these n to the third terms are going to become whole numbers, or real numbers, they're constants. So I will have 3 over 1, or 3. So the intuitive summary of this idea boils down to how fast are these functions going to infinity? If I have a slower function over a faster one, it's going to zero. N squared over n to the third, that went to zero, right? If the rates of the two functions are mathematically the same, these were both n to the third. These were both the same class of function. Then it's going to go to some non-zero number. I'm just going to call it L for now. Right? It goes to a number. You have to work a little bit to figure out what that number is. Okay. And then if the value up top is faster, then we're going to infinity. And then this is just informal. I'm not using the mathematical notation. Just as a way of approaching something, you can get an intuitive idea of what you're expected to get. Okay. Now, there is another technique for finding something like this. And it actually, this technique that we used here works really well with polynomials. And even though it's a lot of writing, it's one step, and it's also the sort of thing that once you've done it, you can start seeing it intuitively, and you don't necessarily need to do all the work, all the writing. But another way I could have approached that is L'Hopital's rule. For all of ours, there'll be infinities. The limit as x approaches infinity of two functions being divided, as long as they both go to infinity or both go to zero, or some other indeterminate form that we can write this way, the limit of the two functions being divided is the same as the limit of the two derivatives being divided. It's not the product rule. We're not talking about what do these functions look like after I take the derivative. It's just saying the derivative of this function is the same as the derivative of, or the limit of this function can be found using the limit of these derivative pairs. X's because we learned L'Hopital's using real value functions. We're taking derivatives, which sort of require the use of real numbers. But remember, if we can describe the limit of a real valued function, the sequence that is associated with it also follows. So if we're going to use L'Hopital's rule, the limit as x approaches infinity of x squared over 5x squared, if I use L'Hopital's rule, what would the first step look like with that? Just to make it non-trivial. There. X squared plus 1. That way it's not true if I can't just cancel the x's and we're done. Of course, now I could just cancel the x's. Cancel the x's, 1 fifth. Everyone okay so far on that? Everyone comfortable then with polynomials and how to tell slower versus faster? you can use, on a quiz or something like that, that's relatively small, if you want to just say, we know that slower over faster goes to zero or something like that, that's okay on a quiz. On a test, I might want you to be a little bit more formal. But that formality could simply be showing L'Hopital's rule. Or showing, you know, just to say, if I divide the top and bottom by n to the third, then I end up with. So show me that you knew the process, even if you don't go through all the tedium of writing all this mess out. If you know what this says, I don't necessarily need to see all of this. Okay? If we're talking about something where I say, write it as if your audience was younger, or like a Calc 1 student or something, then maybe you write it out. If you're writing it out for me for a test or quiz, enough that you can justify the reason. So we're okay with classifying polynomials. Trick is, we have more than just polynomials that we can work with. Let's make a little hierarchy here. So we have our polynomials, our constants, our linears, quadratics, cubics, quartics, quintics, etc. Which way do you want me to go, faster or slower? Polynomials is sort of in the middle. What's that?
Faster.
Okay. No matter how high my degree is, x to the 100th, x to 1 million. At some point, any exponential function will surpass it and move on. What's the difference? What do I mean by exponential? Just as a reminder, a polynomial would be something based off of x to the 5th, an exponential would be something based off of 5 to the x. Hand-wavy way of explaining this. If I'm at the step x equals 4, what does this mean? If x equals 4, what does 4 to the 5th mean? You don't need to give me the numbers. 4 times 4 times 4 times 4 times 4. What does that mean?
5 times 5 times 5 times 5.
If x is 20, what does that mean? 20 times 20 times 20 times 20 times 20. Right? 20 times 20 times 20 times 20 times 20. What does that mean?
5 times 5 times
20 times. 5 times 5 times 5 times 5 times 5. So eventually, can you see, this is always going to be 5 factors. And that's it. This is going to eventually be a lot of factors. Maybe the numbers are smaller, but if I'm taking 100 times itself 5 times, that's less than taking 5 times itself 100 times. Significantly so. All right. So, a quick little hand-wavy explanation. If you want a more formal explanation, L'Hopital's rule. Eventually, a polynomial, when I keep taking the derivative, where's this going to go? First step, 5x to the 4th. And then something x to the 20x to the 3rd. Square. X, 1, 0. As I take the derivative of this, it'll eventually get to a constant or 0. With an exponential, when you take the derivative, you're still going to have a 5 to the x, if it's this one, right? I think it's ln 5 times 5 to the x. I take the derivative again. The 5 to the x is still there. Every time I take to the derivative, that 5 to the x is always there. Right. So, if I'm setting it up with L'Hopital's rule, this will eventually turn constant. This will always stay an increasing function. Right. So L'Hopital's rule is a way that you could demonstrate that. Okay. To go one step slower than a polynomial, roots. roots increase slower than polynomials do. In some cases, you can treat those like polynomials. Other times, L'Hopital will get you what you need. If I had something like this, the fifth root of x squared plus x, algebraically, we may have to mess with it to really get a good handle on the degree, but when you're comparing it to things like this to see how fast they move, this is comparable to the exponent 2/5. The highest degree on the inside divided by its root. Algebraically, you may need to do a little bit if you wanted to demonstrate that algebraically, but as far as looking at it and intuitively saying, I think that moves faster than that. This is how you want to consider it. It's that exponent. Later on here in chapter 9, we're going to get to something called the limit comparison test. Similar idea. You're going to have to take a look at things like what degree are we dealing with. Okay? All right. Let's go a little bit faster. On the other end, let me go slower. We'll do it slower. Logarithms increase slower than roots do. And again, probably the best way to show that would be L'Hopital's rule. Moving faster than my exponentials are my factorials. This one, L'Hopital isn't going to help us because I don't have a nice, neat way at the moment of writing a factorial in terms of a real-valued function. So that you may have to hand wave a little description. You may have to come up with something informal like that. Okay. Now I used n here, if I used x here. If my input variable was 10, here I have 5 times itself 10 times. Right. Up here, some of my terms are lower, 1, 2, 3, 4. But then I also have 5 times 6 times 7 times 8 times 9 times 10. The farther I go, this will always have 5. 5 times 5 times 5 times 5 times 5 times 5. This will eventually have a lot of things more than 5 that I'm multiplying together, but I have the same number of terms. Okay. This one, five times five. I don't know, 127. Whatever, right? I have 1 times 2 times 3 times 4 times 5, and then eventually, if I go far enough, I might even be multiplying by this whole mess down here. So as n keeps increasing, remember, I don't worry about the first few steps. I worry about the last infinite number of steps. Okay. Eventually, this value will take over everything that came before it down here. So factorials increase faster than exponentials. With one little weird exception. If I have n to the n power, that moves faster than factorials do. Hundred to the 100th power is more than 100 factorials. From here down, we use L'Hopital to show. From here up, that you have to do some hand waving and you actually use rules of multiplication and show that sort of idea. But this comparison always holds. So for example, if I had the limit as n approaches infinity of 5 to the n plus 1 over n factorial plus 3, looking at the classes of my functions, are they the same class, so they move at approximately the same rate? Or do I have a faster, slower comparison? Here, my main function, the overtaking function of this top expression, is an exponential. In my denominator, my overarching function is a factorial. Factorials move faster than exponentials, so this is slower over faster. So the limit is what? Zero. If you are writing up something for a math journal, is that enough?
No.
On a quiz where you have 15 minutes to write down an answer and you want to put a little bit of a justification?
Sure.
It also helps with your intuition. If you're approaching a question, you want to have an idea of how it's going to behave before you start trying to do all the mess. So you can look at it and say, all right, I know how this thing's going to behave. Now let me show why it's true. So if you did have to prove it, you can at least know how it's supposed to work, rather than sitting there saying, well, let me mess around and see what happens. Because if you didn't have any sort of intuition, then that's what you'd do. Try example, try example, try example, try to find a conjecture, make a guess, see what's happening. This at least gives you a little bit of a intuitive leaping point. Here's how I think it will behave. Questions on these? So I think we do have one more class set aside to talk about 9.1. I know I'm spending a good bit of time here in this section. And even though it's not necessarily the most technically difficult, it is sort of the section where we are trying to get a handle on all of these little pieces of this new topic. So trying to get everything figured out, make sure we're okay with this new topic of sequences before we really start getting into the heavier parts of it in the next couple of weeks. So next time we're going to, again, stay here in 9.1, taking a look at if I have a list of terms in a sequence, can I come up with the formula? If I'm given something like this, if I'm giving something like that, would I be able to come up with the formula? And so that's what we're going to practice next time. Do you guys want the answer real quick, or do you want to wait until next time? Are you guys curious? So there's the formula I intended. We'll talk a bit about how to try our hand at coming up with those pieces. What are the things we look for when we're trying to build these formulas? Okay. A lot of it boils down to getting used to recognizing certain patterns. I think I alluded to this last time. Most of us are probably comfortable with the perfect squares. If we see a list of 1, 4, 9, 25, 16, 25, 36, we might latch onto that pretty quickly. So if we see something like 2, 5, 10, 17, 26, 37, we may not see it that quickly, but we may recognize those as being in the neighborhood of those perfect squares. In that case, it was n squared plus 1. So getting used to looking for how fast things move, getting used to recognizing other patterns. Oh, that looks like a factorial. That looks like an exponential. That sort of thing. Getting used to that. Okay. And also how to do with alternating. Questions for me. Did anyone get a chance to try looking at the video lecture on Blackboard? It's okay if not. If someone can, just to make sure that I did it right. That's the main thing. I want to make sure I put it in there correctly. It's in Blackboard under video lectures. If for some reason it doesn't work well there, I'll try putting it on YouTube, see if that works any better. But just see if we can. All right, questions or concerns? If not, we'll call it there. Have a good day.
See what happens when we come to it. That's not a big deal.
Thank you.
Yep.